truly enjoyed myself that day. Amen. We thank God and praise God for everyone in their respective places. Amen. Truly, God is great, and He's worthy to be praised. Amen. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the sand, there's no God like our God. He deserves, amen, a ridiculous praise. Amen. Because He can do abundantly and exceedingly above all that you're able to ask or think. Amen. Praising God is a special gift. Amen. Just cast your cares upon Him. Amen. The Bible says, because He cares for you. How many of you know the Lord cares for you? Amen. I thank God for His tender, loving care. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. When the enemy comes in like a flood, hallelujah, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against it. I'm going to put the preacher up, but I was thinking as I was sitting after I had testified, you know how in the scriptures, Paul said in his scriptures, when he writes his epistles, he tells the people in the church whom he's writing to, he says, I always have you in my thoughts and in my prayers. Amen. And as I was sitting there, those scriptures and that salutation that Paul wrote, thank you, Lord, came to my mind, and I said, Lord, that's me. Thank you, Lord. I got Christian ministries in my thoughts and in my prayers. Amen. I'm praying for your great success. That God open new horizons and new doorways. Amen. Thank you, Lord, the new pathways to give you a greater success. Amen. Than you have ever experienced. Come on here, somebody. Hallelujah. I thank God for the vision. I thank God for the leadership here. Hallelujah. I thank God for your diligent work. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Come on here. Hallelujah. I thank God for your testing, your trials. Come on here. Hallelujah. I thank God for your loveliness. Amen. I thank God for your due diligence. Come on, give God a praise. Come on, give God a praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. I love you. I love you. I love you. I come on, shout. Hallelujah. See the Holy Ghost in me testify. Hallelujah. I love you with the love of Jesus. Come on here. Hallelujah. Don't you love each other? Don't y'all love Pastor? Hallelujah. Come on, give God a praise. Hey, hallelujah. And this great man of God, thank you, Jesus. He shocked me this morning. He came to the door. Amen. Amen. This brother, thank you, Lord. They know how to have church. Amen. Greater Bethlehem Temple in Rochester, New York. Amen. Hallelujah. You know how to praise God. Thank you, Lord. I was thinking of that song when we were singing Leaning on Jesus. They got their own version of Leaning on Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Lord. It was really anointed. Amen. And then Pastor Elder Renford, that brother don't fool you. Amen. He can lead a testimony and praise worship service. Amen. I said, man, I'm going to have you up just to lead the praise and worship. Thank you, he's a better. Amen. He's a preacher of the word of God. So let us stand to our feet. Amen. Let us, and his daughters ain't no joke either. Amen. I'm just thinking about them. Amen. And we was at the unity meeting. And what's your daughter, the one that prayed? What's her name?
Nicole.
Nicole. Oh my. Oh, didn't she do a beautiful job? Amen. I felt like I was in heaven. Amen. I told her, I said, I'm going to give you my phone number. I want you to pray and I want to record it. Amen. So I can just listen to it. Amen. Well, just that dynamic.
Amen.
Amen. Taking you to the throne of grace.
Amen.
Hallelujah. That takes something. That means something. Amen. You got to spend time with Jesus to allow that to happen. Amen. Come on here, somebody. Tell your neighbor, relationship is everything. Get rid of religion. Religion won't do you no good. Hallelujah. But relationship, hallelujah, is everything. Amen. So without further ado, I want to present it some and introduce to others. Amen. Elder Mark Anthony, amen, Renford. Let us receive him with a hearty amen.
You may be seated.
Jesus, my Savior, from Bethlehem came. Born in a manger of sorrow and shame. And oh, how wonderful, blessed be his name. Seeking for me.
Is in the will of God.
We
always want to be in God's will. And so I thank God that he so ordained and set this day up, amen, for us to be here. And I'm just glad to be here. I thank God for the blood of Jesus. I'm just thinking, I leaned over and told Ella Quinn, when Pastor Duck was up, and she kind of touching on my message. I said, look at that. I said, but that's one thing God do. He always will send confirmation to everyone. If God got something for you, the thing is going to come easy. If God don't have it for you, it's going to be a lot of hard knocks and ups and downs. So the blessed place to be is when God say yes. Because I heard somebody say, when Jesus said yes, nobody can say no. When Jesus said yes, nobody can say no. Amen. I'd like to call your attention as we go further into the Word of God. I certainly solicit the prayers of the people of God. Amen. And we're going to go into just a passage of Scripture, St. Matthew's Gospel, the 8th chapter. And we're just going to read from verse 1 down to verse number 4. When you have it, you can stand. If you're so able to stand, stand out of respect for the Word of God. Amen. St. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 8.
Let the church stand.
Hallelujah. Amen. When you have it, say amen.
Amen.
Beautiful. Let us read all together. When he was come down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him. And behold, there came a leper and worshipped him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. Jesus put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will, be thou clean. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. And Jesus said unto him, see thou tell no man, but go thy way and show thyself to the priest and offer the gift that Moses commanded for a testimony unto them. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. And what we'd like to leave with you on today is nobody like Jesus. Nobody like Jesus. One of my favorite songs I like to sing, I had a lot. Sometimes I think I can sing and sometimes I can't sing. I mean, different keys, but I think I can sing a little bit. But I love to pray. I love to praise God. The Bible said, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. And so I make a joyful noise. Amen. But I like to sing that song, Can't Nobody Do Me Like Jesus. Can't nobody do me like the Lord. Amen. Because he's my friend. But here we find in this particular scripture, in this story here of Jesus, and how he went to the mountain, and he came down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him. And anytime Jesus would go anywhere or do anything, he always had a crowd, he was always a mass crowd, because people wanted to see him, because they heard and they saw for themselves the miracles that Jesus did, heal the sick, raise the dead, gave sight to the blind, he loosed the dumb's tongue. Amen. And he caused the deaf to be able to hear. And he did so many miracles. He fed the 5,000 with 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread. And he did so many things. So anytime Jesus went around, there was a great crowd of people wanted to come. You know how sometimes somebody come around, some people just be way in the back just so they could be there, just to be able to look. Amen. But when Jesus went to the mountain, and he went to the mountain and desert places many times to pray, amen, because the Bible said for men are always to pray and not to faint.
Yes.
So he would go and pray and still away. Sometimes you gotta still away for to yourself sometime and get to a desert place so God can talk to you and you can talk to God and commune with God. Because if you're going to get anywhere with God, you're going to have to develop a relationship with God, your own personal relationship with God. Amen. So when he came out of the mountain, amen, we find here in the story that the people was around them, a great multitude following. But then in the crowd, there was a leprous man, a man that had a deformity. You know, he had a bad disease. And leprosy is a very contagious disease. It causes damage to the skin. It also it causes the skin and the peripheral nervous system. It's a bacteria, it's a germ. It also disfigures you and it causes you to be kind of disformed.
Yes.
But we find here that when he said, Lord Jesus, he said, I know if you will, you can make me whole. You can make me clean. If you will, Jesus just said, I will. Be thou clean. And when Jesus touched him, the Bible said immediately his leprosy was cleansed.
Yeah.
Jesus said, now what I want you to do is I want you to go and show yourself. Don't tell anybody. Don't tell anybody what happened. But I want you to go and show yourself to the priests. Just like Moses gave commandment was. And we find here in the Old Testament time when a person had leprosy, because if you had that disease, leprosy, you stayed out, you couldn't be around the general population. You couldn't be around people. You had to be incubated, in other words. You had to be an outcast. You had to be out, and you had to let people know, leprosy, unclean, unclean, unclean. You say, ooh, I'm going to stay away from him. Amen. But when they got healed in the Old Testament time with Moses, they had to go and show themselves to the priests. And the priest would look at them to see if they were cleansed or healed from their leprosy. And then the priest would go and take two live birds.
Yeah.
And out of the two live birds, they would take one of the live birds. Couldn't be a sickly looking bird, but it had to be a healthy, two healthy birds. And they would kill the one bird over running water. Amen. And they would keep the other bird alive.
Yeah.
Now the priest would also take cedar wood, and he would take scarlet, and he would take hyssop, and cedar wood is something in that wood. It improves the focus and gives wisdom. It helps hair to grow. It has an anti-inflammatory agents in it. It can cure toothaches. This is all cedar wood now, and it's something. Everything in the Bible that God says and does, there's a significant reason for it. If he said do this, use this kind of wood, then you better use this kind of wood and not do your own thing, because now you just messed up with God. But also cedar wood, it reduces skin irritations. It relieves spasms, and it cures fungal infections. This is cedar wood. Scarlet is a brilliant of a red color. It's real red. It's a red red. And hyssop is a wild shrub, a shrub that it doesn't really have an identity, but it is used in Old Testament time. They would use the hyssop for sprinkling on people for the ancient Jewish rites for purification. But they would take these ingredients along with the blood of the dead bird, and then they would take the live bird and dip the live bird into the blood with all these ingredients. This is what the priest had to do to the leper. And then they would take it and they would sprinkle seven times on the leper. And after they sprinkled seven times on the leper, the priest would say, "You are clean." And they would be clean, and then they would be able to go into society. And it's something about hyssop. I think about when David prayed in Psalm 51. He said, "Lord, purge me with hyssop. Created me a clean heart, O God." You see, it's something about purification, and God always wants his people to be pure and clean and do what's right. I'm talking about there's nobody like Jesus. The Bible also said himself took our infirmities. And he bare our sicknesses. You see, Jesus is everything that we need. Infirmities is a physical or mental weakness that we have. And this is what sin causes. It causes physical and mental weaknesses. And the Bible said that Jesus took them himself. He took them and bore them on the cross. There's nobody like Jesus. Somebody said he picked me up one day and he turned me around. He placed my feet on solid ground. This same Jesus that was born in Bethlehem of Judea. He was laid in a manger. They wrapped him in swaddling clothes. And the three kings came and they brought him gold and frankincense and myrrh. This same Jesus that as he was growing up at the age of 12 years old, he was sitting in the temple talking to the lawyers and the doctors. They didn't understand how could a young child be so brilliant as him. But they didn't know that he was the Son of God. He was the one that was going to be the Savior of the world, to save mankind from their sin. There's nobody like Jesus. Nobody can do you like Jesus. That's why when Jesus touched anybody's life, they got all excited and had to go and run and tell somebody. Somebody said, "I used to be an alcoholic, but somebody told me about a man called Jesus. And when I heard what Jesus can do for me, I went down in Jesus' name. And I'm not an alcoholic anymore. Somebody said I used to be a drug addict. I was strung out on marijuana. I was strung out on cocaine. But somebody told me about Jesus. Because there's nobody like Jesus. He blazed the trail. No wonder Isaiah, the eagle-eyed prophet, said, he said, look at here. He was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement of our peace was on him. And with his stripes we are healed. The Bible said, all we like sheep have gone astray. And that's why the Lord laid on Jesus the iniquity of us all. Because he bore our sins. He carried our sorrows in his humiliation. And in his judgment, he was smitten of God and afflicted. Nobody can do me like Jesus. He's the Savior of the world. He told them, he said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all men unto me. And that's why he told his disciples, he said, I want you to go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. He go and told them again in St. Matthew 24. He said, go and preach repentance and remission of sins in my name, beginning at Jerusalem. Because can't nobody do me like Jesus. Nobody like Jesus. That's why they said, never man spake like this man. He, look at him. He did forgive sins. Look at him. When he died on the cross, gave up the ghost, went down and preached to those that were in bondage. And when he rose the third day, he led captivity captive. He gave gifts unto men. He said, go out and tell a dying world that they can be saved. Nobody like Jesus. Nobody like Jesus. Nobody like Jesus. When he can take somebody from the dance room floor, take somebody from the dope house, take somebody from walking the streets. Nobody but Jesus. Nobody but Jesus. He's the one. He's the Son of God. He's the Holy One. He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He's the root and offspring of David. He's the seed of Abraham. He's Jesus. Bible says himself, he took our infirmities. He bare our sicknesses. He carried our sorrows. He's acquainted with grief. Nobody like Jesus. Nobody like Jesus. And this is what we need to do today. We're living in a time that people don't understand. People don't believe that Jesus can save. To the uttermost, Jesus saved. And this is why the nations of the world are in trouble. Because they took the prayer out of the schools. They don't believe that they got to do it the way God said to them. The Bible said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Nobody like Jesus that'll save your soul. He'll pick you up. He'll make you whole. He'll take you. He'll fix your life. He'll give you peace in the midst of confusion. He'll fix it. Yeah. The nations are in trouble. The world is in trouble. Nobody can do us like Jesus. God sent a Savior, but the people rejected him. The Bible said they rejected him. They rejected him. And the Bible lets us know, how can you escape the damnation of hell if you neglect so great of salvation? Jesus took our physical and mental weaknesses, the issues that we're going through and we're fighting the struggles. We got problems. We got troubles. We don't know what to do. We don't know which way to turn. But you got to give them to Jesus, because he's the only one that can do us. He's the only one that can save us. He's the only one that can fix the situation. He's Jesus. I can see Jesus when the man that was bound in chains, he lived in the cemetery. Nobody could chain him. The Bible said he beat himself. Nobody was like a wild man. But one day here comes Jesus. My God, Jesus came. Because Jesus is somebody. And he said, Jesus, you have come to torment me before time. Lord Jesus. Jesus said, hold your peace. Come out of him. The Bible said the demonic man that lived in the cemetery, he was naked, didn't could keep clothes on. My God, people knew he was strange. People knew he had issues, just like some of us. You know, people have issues. People got problems. People don't know what to do. But I'm telling you, there's nobody like Jesus. Nobody but Jesus can fix it. You gotta surrender to it to him. You gotta ask him. Like the man that had the leprosy. When Jesus came out of the mountain, he said, Jesus, he said, you can heal me if you will. Jesus said, I will. He said, be thou whole. And the man was made whole that very hour. If you say, Jesus, I need you to help me. Help my home. Help my family. Help my children. Help my situation. I can't make it by myself. I need Jesus and Jesus alone. I thank God for the blood. Somebody said, what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. I'm talking about it was the blood that stained the old rugged cross. When Jesus hung on the cross from the sixth to the ninth hour, the Bible tell me they pierced him in the side. Out came water. Then came blood. When they washed the bird on the running water, my God, then they took the blood to be able to for the cleansing. Somebody said, it's the blood. The blood still works. Whatever your problem, you better give it to Jesus, because he's coming back again for a church without spot or wrinkle, without blemish or any such thing. Somebody that believes the report. No wonder Isaiah said, Lord, who have believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? Talked about Jesus was going to grow up like a tender plant. He was going to tread the wine fat because nobody was able to go with him. Some of his own disciples weren't able to stand with Jesus. He's a mighty man. There's something about Jesus. There's nobody like him. Nobody can do it. He's a friend to the friendless. He's a mother to the mothers. He's a healer. He's a deliverer. He's a way maker. He's a problem fixer. He's a healer. He's my help. He's food when you're hungry. He's food when you're hungry. I need you to help me. Help me to hold out. Help me to make it until my change comes. Tell that mountain, get out of my risen from the dead. He told his disciples. He said, you go down and tarry in Jerusalem, tarry near the way. And they waited for the promise. Bible said after Jesus rose the third day, it was 40 days. 40 days he was walking around, eating with them, communing with them. They were seen of him by many infallible proofs, seen of 500 people at one time. Oh, but then after they went to Jerusalem, 10 days after that, 40 and 10 make 50. On the 50th day, the Holy Ghost fell. My God. Nobody like Jesus. We got problems. We got situations. We got things that we need God to do for us. People are dying. Souls are being destroyed. And all they got to do is come to Jesus. Jesus said, whosoever will, let him come and drink of the water of life freely. He told the woman at the well, he said, if anybody drink of this water, he said, they will never thirst again. You'll never be thirsty. I don't care where you go, who you meet, there's no amount of money in the world that can compare to Jesus, the Holy Ghost. Once a person get the whole, the genuine, come on, tongue talking, Holy Ghost. The one that David said in Psalm 51. He said, whatever you do, Lord, take not the Holy Spirit from me. I'll be like a ship without a sail. Maybe if you'd have caught me 38 years ago, you probably could have bought me. But you can't buy me now. You can't buy me. They say you can have all the money you want. You can do whatever you want. Just give up Jesus. I'll say, I'll take Jesus for mine. I'll take Jesus for mine. You can have this whole wide world, but I'll take Jesus for mine. Oh, nobody like you. You know something? No wonder the Apostle Paul, I believe it was in Corinthians. And he said, God chose to save the people by the foolishness of preaching. Because sometimes when people come to church and they see somebody, it almost look foolish, like, oh my goodness, what is this? It's unorthodox. But this is the way God chose to save people. Because all people have to do is just say, you know what? I believe.
I believe.
I believe. The man said, yea, Lord, I believe. Help thou my unbelief. Jesus said, greater works you will do. My goodness. Nobody like Jesus. Nobody like Jesus. The Lord is getting ready to come. I'm telling the people of God, look at what's happening in the world today. Look at the nations of the world, not only in America, not only in this country, not only in Erie, Pennsylvania, but in New York State, in all 50 states, and not only these states, but the countries of the world. People are hurting. People are dying. We are in trouble because we've gone so far away from God. We've gone so far from God. Break down in families. Break down in home. Break down in church. Just all kinds of ills. Yes. When all we got to do is bring it to Jesus. When they took the prayer out of the schools. When I remember growing up as a little boy, they had prayer in school. You pray. If you didn't believe in prayer and didn't want to pray, you just sat there and been quiet. Don't bother nobody. But you didn't have the insects. Amen. Teachers molesting boys and girls. You didn't have the pregnancies and all the guns and the violence and all the stuff that goes on in schools now. It's so unsafe. You be afraid to send your children to school. You better get you some ball get you. Come here, baby. In Jesus' name, you anoint your children with oil before you send them out the door. Because there's devils out there. A real devil that play for keeps. He don't play for play. That's why Jesus never fails. We need to go back. Somebody said, take me back, Lord. Take me back to the place where I first received you. Let me say this. God is not going to let his son Jesus come and suffer and die on the cross of Calvary. Don't you know Jesus was humiliated?
Yes.
He was humiliated. Yes. Many of us, if I ask the question, how many of you have been embarrassed before? I'm sure every hand will go, oh, I'm so embarrassed. Your children are embarrassed. You make God embarrassed. You be embarrassed. But Jesus was humiliated. They clucked his beard. They slapped him. They spit on him. They treated him. They beat him to a bloody pulp. They treated him inhumanely. They put a blindfold on. The Bible said they put a blindfold on Jesus. And they took the palms of their hands and they slapped him. And then they said, ha, tell us this, you a prophet. Who was it that slapped you? God, the Bible has not said God is not going to let his suffering servant go through all that and all the world just go free. He was just a nice old fellow. I don't believe in take all that. I don't have to surrender my life. You got to surrender your life. You got to give it to Jesus. You got to surrender all. You can't hold back nothing. You got to give it all to him. Give him your children. Your wayward children, that's backslid. Give them your family, your husband, your wife. Give them situations on your job. You're going through devils and hell and torment. Give it to Jesus. Because he's the only one that can fix them. The songwriter said, Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him, there's no other. Jesus is the way. Prayer out of the schools. Look at our schools now. Yes. It's not almost safe to send your children to school. Because at any time somebody can take out a gun or a knife or anything. Yes. A teacher could be molesting them. People could be bullying them. Just all kind of crazy drug and just all kind of stuff goes on. People need help. People need help. People need help. And I thank God for Jesus. And I like about that leprous man. He didn't care about the big crowd. He didn't care who was all around him. Sometimes we get ashamed. Yeah, I need to do that. I need to make a change. They looking at me. But let me tell you something. If you end up in hell, they ain't gonna be thinking about what you look like in hell. Because people are going to be having their own problems. So you better do something for yourself. He did not care. He said, Jesus, if you will, you can make me clean. He wanted to be clean. The drug addicts want to be clean. The prostitute want to be clean. The gangbangers want to be clean.
Yes.
But you got to come to Jesus. He said, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. And in my closing, and I'm giving amen. In my clothes. The songwriter said, where you gonna be when the fire start falling? Fire is gonna start falling.
I don't believe that.
They didn't believe it was gonna rain when Noah preached. Noah preached 120 years. know it rained. It never rained before. It's in Genesis.